Good morning, everyone. Today's lesson is coming out of Judges chapter 3, verses 15 through 25, as well as 29 through 30. Alright. Before we start, as normal, we'll begin with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. This morning, we praise and honor. Thank you for keeping us. Lord, there are so many things that go on throughout each day that we are unaware of, but you kept us. Lord, as you brought us here this morning, we ask that you teach us, guide us, Lord, because we know that we need your word. It's in your instructions, in your laws, in your precepts, that we are successful and that we maintain our relationship with your word. So lead us, God, in this lesson plan. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Anybody know anything about this lesson? What's going on? Anybody know anything about it? So what we have here is we have the children of Israel. It's a new generation. They're now coming into the land. They have came into the land, and they have now put themselves inside the land. But they did not get rid of all the people who were prior to them, in this land. So what happens, they had a covenant with God that it was not going to follow anybody else. But like we all know, we get close to our neighbors, get close to seeing other people do other things, and we think that's okay. So this group of new generation of Israelites have now broken covenant. And as usual, we all know the story, how these things can take place and what happens when you break the covenant of God. This is a binding law that God has with them. So the concept I would like for y'all to pay attention to would be understanding the causes and effects and understanding what law is. Law is nothing but instructions. All right. So when you read verses chapter 1, you see that it's a new generation coming into the land who does not, is different from the Joshua generation. Joshua, when they were with Joshua, they followed Joshua. They followed the word of God. And that generation kept them. But now, there's a new generation, and this is what they're dealing with now. Second, going to the second chapter, you see the rebuke of it, or of them, for not obeying the covenant. So now we get into chapter 3, where our story starts. And in our story, we see that we learn that they have different people inside the land, but also they have started to mingle with them, marry some of their women, and give their daughters to these people, and start to serve some of their gods. So now we jump into our story. So can somebody take verses 15 through 16 for me?
When the children of Israel cried out to the Lord raised them up a deliverer. Uzziah, son of Jerah, a Benjamite, a man left-handed, and by him the children of Israel sent a present unto Eglon, the king of Moab. But Uzziah made him a dagger, which had two edges of a cubit in length, and he did gird it under his raiment upon his right thigh.
All right. So, can anybody know what's going on in this? Anybody know?
Here you have the children of Israel have realized they've done wrong. Now they're repenting and crying out to Jesus, the Lord, for help. And the Lord is taking pity upon them to send someone to rescue them.
Anybody else? All right. So what we have here, as well as you said, is the children of Israel now crying back out. They're in trouble now. But they're subject to Eglon, the king of Moab. They're subject to him now. Like anything else, when you break the law, we give rise to another authority. So you drive down the street, break the traffic light, or law, red light. Now the authorities have the right to punish you. You give them authority over you now to now be punished. We see this in this theme going on and on again. You know, even in the garden, you see where death was already there. God told them if they eat a tree, you should surely die. I mean, death, the consequence of death was already there. But death had no authority to touch them until actually when they ate the tree. So they gave authority and allowed for something to now take place over them. Now here is in this situation, they're breaking covenant with God. And so now something else is now being able to take authority over them. Like anything else in life, we do a lot of dumb things, and now we're being subject to the punishment. We have to be subject to this. So they were mingling with these people. They started to serve some of their other gods. So when they broke the covenant, the warranty of God has been taken away. As long as you're following me, I got you. Following my instructions, I got you. But when you decide to go do anything else, I don't have to, follow through in your protection. Because you are not longer working under me. You have violated our law, our covenant. It's like any other thing. You got a product. And when you void the warranty, the manufacturer is no longer responsible for covering what's going on. So, but then we have another thing we see is Ehud. He's a Benjamite. He's a Benjamin. He's from the tribe of Benjamin. Left-handed man. And he must have been a leader at the time. And he's going to be the deliverer in the story. But now they're under the subject, under the rule of Eglon, the Moab. And so now this is basically the cause and the effect situation. You did wrong, now you gotta pay punishment. And your punishment is this guy is not going to make you subject to him. And then we talk about, that's verse 16. Verse 16 deals with the idea that he who now, after he repented and got back right with God, he's now inspired to now go and by God to be the deliverer. So can somebody go with verses 17 for me?
And he brought the present to Eglon, king of Moab, and Eglon was a very fat man.
All right. What's going on? I got kind of quiet, and I'm the only one here. I gotta do some jumping jacks or something to get y'all going. What's going on?
Jumping jacks.
There's a significance to the verse saying that Eglon was a very fat man, but I don't want to get ahead.
That's why I stopped. Yeah. That's what I was supposed to be 18 to a 9. That's why I stopped.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But we'll see as we go on why they mentioned that.
Yes.
And why also why they mentioned that
Right.
Yes.
It made a difference.
And it makes a major difference inside the stories. When you know the stories, you kind of get those points. But you also, I want y'all to catch the theme. There's a cause and effect. Somebody else is now over you. Somebody is now ruling you. And God's no longer king in your life. Something else will become king. And so I want you to understand this is the problem that we are facing in our lives. We start to face these same situations. When we break laws, and laws are nothing but instructions. So when we break the instructions, we go against the instructions, then we are, what's it called, subject to the demise or the effect. That's basically what sin is, you know. There's an instruction, this is how I want you to live, this is what I want you to do. But when we break that, we go away from that, then basically now we got to deal with the punishment, cause and effect. Now, we also see that there is a problem when you don't follow God. So you bring it back. I'm trying to reiterate the idea, and you guys kind of like, you know, kind of looking at me with scared faces.
So where we are thus far is like a parent reprimanding their child. They keep telling the child, you're doing wrong, do the right thing. And you know wrong from right. But because it's so easy to do wrong, it's like the of Israel, they found it so easy to do wrong under the King Eglon, who was given instruction of his own. You know, he wasn't following any leadership of God. And then so the Lord let us, as Christians, he let us sometimes suffer a little bit before he step in or send somebody that can help get us on track. And as parents, we find with our children, we always reprimand them. And tell them wrong from right, best of our ability, but they still insist on doing wrong. And so I used to tell my soldiers, are you going to take the easy route or are you going to take that hard left? Make your decision, come back and talk to me. And it gives them something to think about. Am I going to continue staying on this track that I know I shouldn't be on? Or I'm going to do the hard thing and get right, you know, in the situation and move forward. That's kind of what's going on here under this King Eglon, who is the Moabite.
Yeah.
Really don't follow the instructions of God.
And I guess the problem with this story, it jumps us right into the story. So we don't get the actual full understanding of what they're actually doing.
Right.
And how this stuff started off. So we can go to verse 18 now. Can somebody read verse 18?
And when he had made an end to offering the present, he sent away the people that bear the present.
All right. So we see that they have to pay tribute to these people. Now you give authority to somebody else. When you break the law, you got to give authority to somebody else. Now you've got to pay tribute to these people. So this is what they're doing. They're going to Eglon, and they have to pay tribute to this guy. Every so often, I don't know if it was a year, I don't know if it was a couple months, they got to pay tribute to this guy. Can somebody take verse 19 from me?
But he himself turned again from the queries that were by Gilgal and said, I have a secret errand unto thee, O king, who said, keep silence. And all that stood by him went out from him.
All right. Anybody know what's going on?
When he said he had a present for him, he sent his people away and told them, don't say nothing yet, just be quiet, let them go out there. So he went between the two of them.
Yes. Now, apparently, some people believe he was a prophet. So he had sway and believed that when he went to the king and said something, that gave the king a reason to want to talk to him.
And the word secret.
Secret, yes.
Yeah. In that verse.
So what did the king do? Keep everybody out because he wanted to hear what's going on.
But I kind of felt like he thought some good was coming to him. He wanted the rest of them to know, you know?
Yeah.
Because he was that kind of person, you know, that was so personal about me, self, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, you've been in a situation where you might have known some information that you thought might kind of issues going on with the other tribes.
Well, that too, but since they were doing a tribute to him, I thought maybe that was maybe his idea and thought. You know, the Bible didn't say so. It might have just me thinking.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, because he's all that, you know.
Yeah, it does not clarify what it is.
Right.
It could be any one of those things.
Right.
The idea is he found it worthy of him to gain the audience.
Right. Okay. God's plan.
Yes. So we see that once we get in God's plan, God starts to set up things for us.
That's right.
So now the instrument of God's deliverance has now been able to get an audience with the problem of the children of Israel. So once Israel got back in alignment with God, now they're going to have deliverance. So now Ehud is now able to get an audience with the king, Elam, and they're going to have a discussion. All right. Can somebody take verses 20 for me?
And Ehud came unto him, and he was sitting in a summer parlor, which he had for himself alone. And Ehud said, I have a message from God unto thee. And he arose out of his seat. Because he kind of thought, I'm thinking that he was thinking, God sending me a message, I am somebody. You know, to me, that's the feeling that I get from reading this. It's not that, like you said, it wasn't stated anywhere. And you think he's above everybody. And it could have been that, you know, saying, God sent me somebody, better listen. Or it could have been saying, I am somebody, God sending me a message.
Yes.
You know?
Anyone else?
And I think also in that verse ahead when it says secret, he was so curious to find out, like, maybe what did I do so well?
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm so arrogant and I sit above and I can't do wrong. Yeah. And now God is sending me a message. I must be
somebody. Yeah, I think
somebody.
That's why he stood, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's possible.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes we all do it.
Yeah.
I'm very curious. Like I said, I want to know what that secret. Mm-hmm. And if this is a message from God, I definitely think, you know, it's something good for me, so a blessing coming in. And that could have been his thought at this time.
Really?
Especially when you don't know you're doing wrong.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right.
Right. Like I said, many scholars believe that he was a prophet. And so when he told he had a message for him, God, he wanted to hear it. So he got everybody out, and he came in there to actually talk to him. Now we see how the dagger now comes into play.
Mm-hmm.
So indeed, I think he did have a message for him, a poem, but maybe not the message he was looking for.
Right. That's right.
So which one we start at? 21?
That's not the 20.
All right, can you take 21 through 22?
Put forth his left hand and took the dagger from his right side and thrust it into his belt. And the half also went after the blade and the fat closed upon the blade so that he could not draw the dagger out of his belt and the dirt came out.
Yes, sir.
And it's a message you don't want right there.
Exactly. It does. It means something else.
Now, one of the points when he was talking to him, or the idea we got up was because they believed back in the days that when they get a prophet to talk to somebody, they talk to them in a little whisper. So they would say something, so that's the reason he got up. But we also see how the dagger plays in concealment. He was left-handed. You know, most people are right-handed, so it may not have provoked him to think anything about it. You know, the right hand, he ain't going to, for most people, they probably dominant hand, he went to the left hand. He used a cubic-sized dagger, like a foot and a half, and put on the side of his thigh.
That tells you, too, he was very, very belly big.
Yes.
You know? And that when he stood up, when he thrust it in, that helped the strength of his arm for it to go all the way
yeah.
and be covered. the way it was covered, that he defecated on himself.
It must have been a hard stab, too.
Yes, yes.
I mean,
yes.
He had a piercing and take it all the way back there. That's
right.
a lot of strength to go through there.
That's right.
But it was a very specific dagger.
Yes, it was.
He constructed the dagger, mm-hmm. He constructed it with two ends.
Two ends.
So he already knew that he was fat, so he knew he had to have something that could penetrate the fatness to remove the dirtiness.
Yep. And you know, I think one of the major parts is when we get back in line, we see how God starts to set things back up.
Mm-hmm.
So he gets there and he was able to get an audience with the king. There was no interference at the time. And God, you know, gave him the vision to get this dagger and how to construct it and what he was supposed to do with it. Mm-hmm. And with that, he was able to not only subdue or kill king, but he was able to have it where there was nobody there around to try to stop him or even kill him at the time.
Mm-hmm, right.
So he was able to get away. Well, go ahead, my bad. I'm sorry. But he was able to, you know, do what he came there to do,
mm-hmm.
without any of his people
right.
being in danger at the time.
Victory is mine.
All right, can somebody read verses 23?
And he went forth through the porch and shut the doors of the parlor upon him and locked them. Smart thing.
The smart man.
Smart. Smart thing. Locking the doors.
Yeah.
So no one else could get in while he could get away.
Yeah, it's also amazing how, I don't know if this took his breath away, but he couldn't yell when he killed him.
Yeah.
So he didn't make a noise, so he didn't alarm nobody else. So nobody, none of his servants who probably was outside or who were listening, because he's a king.
Mm.
So their job is to protect him. And so he's in there, and he didn't make a sound, and he just killed him. And so now he's able to hide right now and basically get away.
And now I'm saying it's amazing to me, too, by you saying he was a king, even though he sent them away. It seems like they would have been standing still at the
yes.
door, at the guard, you know, because he's a king.
Yes.
But God made it that way that when he told them to go away, they went away, and no one was there.
That
was amazing to me too, that they weren't standing on the red, even though he had somebody in there with them.
Yes. Yeah. Usually sometimes kings had advisors that yeah. wanted to hear what's going on. Or somebody to support them just
right.
in case something did happen.
God locks at the door,
yeah. But
he was so curious about the secret that he probably sent them far away because he didn't want them to know if he was getting something good.
Yeah.
And that was so selfish as possibly of the king. Go far away. Close enough to hear anything.
Yeah.
He
yeah.
should have gasped.
Yeah, that's why I said it's amazing to me that no God was still at the door.
Exactly.
Even though he sent him away, he's a king.
Exactly.
He, you know, always has somebody somewhere close by.
You know.
Exactly.
So you see how God operates and starts doing it when we get in line. So it's not so much as God could have did it, it's when we get in line. We got to be mm-hmm. co-participants in him. God, his name, gives us laws and we got to come with him. But when we were saying break that covenant, he's no longer authorized to warrant that covenant. But when we get back in line, we start to see that God would then warrant covenant, so he will protect us and do what we need at the current time. That's why Jesus talks about seeking. You got something to say?
I'm sorry, but today we know we have classified information, top secret, stuff like that. So the king. When he sent his military people away, you know, because he didn't want them to hear the secret information that was sort of like seep through the doors that they could hear. So he sent them farther away because he was arrogant and he thought that was on his own stuff. So now he didn't have no help. He got down my mom for help because nobody was around, but he sent them too far away.
Yeah.
That's his arrogant told on him.
Yes. So this is important why we see we get back in line, because Jesus talks about this too, seeking the kingdom of first and his righteousness and all these things be added to. The first thing is to seek the kingdom and get in right standing, right? Once you got in right standing, then everything else you need comes behind it. But first you got to be in right standing.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times we get that what's name mixed up, you know. We think we just need the answer right now, but God's saying, hey, in order to get the answer, you got to get alive first. All right, so, you know, verse 24, okay, can somebody take 24, please?
When he when he was gone out, his servants came, and when they saw that, behold, the doors of the parlor were locked, they said, surely he covered his feet in his summer chamber.
So he comes to the door, they don't think much about it. They think it's something business as usual, right? None suspicious. This is giving now Ehud the opportunity to get out, right?
But does that mean that maybe they thought he was in the bathroom?
It doesn't really say.
It says covered his feet with summer chambers. That's what it means. I think that's what it's saying to the restroom. Like, I mean, I'll say restroom for our time. You know, maybe they thought that's what he was. Of course, he was.
Yeah. When I studied it, it was talking about being in the porch, sitting on the porch or something like that, in a cool area.
But he had come back in.
Can somebody take verses 25?
And they tarried until they were ashamed, and behold, he opened not the doors of the parlor. Therefore they took a key and opened them, and behold, their Lord was fallen down dead on the earth.
He was dead.
Mm-hmm.
But by then, you read verses 26, but Ehud had escaped while he delayed. Mm-hmm. So he had already escaped by the time they decided to go in him.
That's right.
So God had made a way for them to escape.
That's right.
All right, so I think that's the end of this part, and we're going to drop to 29 to 30, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so somebody take 29 and 30.
And they slew of Moab at that time about 10,000 men, all lusty, and all men of valor, and there escaped not a man. So Moab was subdued that day under the hand of Israel, and the land had rest 40 years.
All right.
So they took Moses.
So he was able to escape at the time, go home, rally the troops. That's basically what it's going to say in the middle of the problem. And he was able to subdue them. So the key here, they were able to subdue what was opposing them. God had made a way for them.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times we forget that we are a part of the situation. We have to get in line. A lot of times we are the causes, and the problems we have are the effects. So every time we decide to go out of the will of God, or we do our own thing, basically not follow instructions, we then give rise to things that we don't like. So we have to pay the penalty. That's all this is, cause and effect. We broke the law. There was a covenant that between God and the children of Israel. They decided to go do something different. They decided to go do what's new, what's fancy, what's the latest thing around them. And they broke the covenant. Now they was named subject to something they didn't like. And basically, this is what happened when they got back in line with God. Then things start to happen in their favor. We find that when we get ourselves back in line, start doing things according to what is instructed to us, things work out the way we want it to work out. And so after that, we see that it was 80 years of rest. So now that generation has learned what not to do, and they're now doing the right thing. The leaders are now teaching them. But then what's going to happen later on is new generation comes in, and they don't know this stuff. And this is how people fall away. So our elders tell us things and try to explain to us. But because we haven't been around that way of seeing those things, we kind of think they don't know what they're talking about. And then we get in trouble. And sometimes some things we fall prey to, we don't recover. A lot of times we can sometimes. Yeah.
So we just don't know what's real. But if you always tell God, you're going to start on it.
Yes. Well, you were about to say something? No?
Yeah. Well, now I was going to compare destiny to, like we get caught up in the world events that's going on around us. And coming to church seems so special. Like, but then you can go and do worldly things, more common. So, you know, when we see a person that's really, you know, you can tell that go to church, that's a special person. So now how can we, I know that sounds crazy, but just like here, you have to be strong enough to get away from those sin, from the sinful things in the world. And those things that we constantly lust after, you know, in this lesson here, they were strong enough, courageous enough to overcome that. Even though everybody had merged into that lifestyle. And God, you know, chose them that was believed in them enough to be strong enough to go and stand before the king and do what it took place there. So basically,
that's a benefit when we find the error in our ways. Solomon says there's nothing new under the sun. So this story is going to repeat itself because new people show up and they don't see the benefit of the old wisdom. Or is it, you know.
We also see the example of two leadership. When the righteous is in charge, when the righteous leadership is in charge, people rejoice. But when you have a bad leadership in charge, people moan and groan.
Yes.
So you cut the head of the king and you kill the sin. Righteous man in there, then
they
can rain good.
And also, passing down information of what happened in history, you know, in these people placed there. And sometimes we look around church and we don't see kids in the church. You know, we don't see things going on that should be going on where the youth should be doing things. Parents should have their kids in church, but they have other things going on Sunday. They get so involved, and all of a sudden you see where they grow up and leave the house and get in trouble or do crazy, you know. And then now, you know, you see things happen like that so often. You know, you wonder, you know, did they really learn? You know, when they were learning ABCs, did they learn how to spell the Bible, learn about Christ? We don't just become to learn. You know, at a younger age. So they would be strong enough, have faith enough in God to stray away from those things. You know?
Yeah. I think a lot of times people don't see the value of certain things at the time. And I was speaking for my own self. I was grateful that my parents took me to church on a regular basis, but like most people, I decided to go outside and test the waters because that was the nature of how people operate, you know. I want to see what's in front of me. I want to enjoy what they're giving, you know, out there. But I would say I was thankful to God that nothing I did, you know, put a hurt on me that bad that I couldn't recover. There's some people, you know, get out there and that stuff really put a hurt on them where, you know, it's hard to recover from. And so we all have our own testimony. Probably went out there trying to enjoy ourselves and saw the error of our ways. But thank God we have Christ in us already that we was able to come back. And we see we can now tell everybody else, hey, you know, the story and why what they was doing, why what we were doing ain't the answer. Why Christ is the answer. That's one of the major points. Because we all go out there and we all try to roll out on it.
I say too, when we're young, when we're growing up, we do foolish things.
Yes.
And we out with our peers and all, we do young, foolish things. Sometimes we're raised in the church, sometimes we're not. But the thing of it is, after all, is that we have those parents that pray for us.
Yes.
We have those parents that try to instill in us what is right and what is wrong. Even when I was out there doing all my things, Christ died for me. And that is one thing that I hold to because I was raised up in a church and like I said, your mind, as you grow and as you go, you do remember those days in church. You do remember what mom and dad put in you, what you heard the pastor say, and you know that they're constantly praying for you and that prayer works.
That's important.
That prayer works.
That's right.
Amen. It works. Amen.
I so agree with that. And it's so good to know tactical move, and the people didn't expect it. As you said, they normally were right-handed dominant, so they weren't expecting the sneak attack.
That's right.
So for us as children, he gave us the Bible. Mm-hmm. He gave us leaders, shepherds, ministers to help guide us. And as parents, we don't know how to be parents, but we become parents. But we learn, we read, and we acquire those tools that we need to do the best that we can. Mm-hmm. And I think E-HUD is a really good example of that for us.
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to add to that free will. God, in His love, His mercy, and His grace, He gave all of us free will to do whatever and to make the choices that we desire to make. Yet He loved us so much that He made provision for us to escape the penalty and receive the plan of salvation. So we see all of that in this particular lesson. Although the guys were standing outside of the door, like some of us, me in particular, probably would be yapping. The door was locked, so they assumed everything is okay. And sometimes we assume everything is okay. But the good thing about that, God has not forgotten us, even in our sin and even in our disobedience. He's still working a plan out. So if we just can hold on to the faith and to the word of God, everything is going to work out, even as it worked out for Enoch in our lesson.
Anybody else have a comment from the close? Everything's settled. I appreciate you guys showing up. We'll go to the word of prayer, and then we'll close out. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you again. We just pray that you, that something was said that resonated with people in here, that they will learn from this example, Lord. And not only learn from himself, but able to share it to other folks that they come in contact with, Lord. So we thank you as we go on this day, that you continue to protect us and guide us. Lead us according to your will and your ways, Lord, as we need it, Lord. In Christ Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen.